Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome Dr. Joe McCord. I feel good. I knew that I would not. I feel good. I knew that I would not.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here in San Diego again, and I want to thank all of you for being here. I don't know who that handsome dude is there from the sort of a George Hamilton skin tone going on. By the way, I was the best man. There was a groom on the other side of... but I photoshopped him right out of the picture. The picture's a little fuzzy, but after thinking about it, that whole decade was a little fuzzy. I have a couple of things to talk to you about today. And they're kind of related themes. They're both about staying tuned. And the first part of this was instigated by something that happened earlier this month, one of the science calls. I hope you all tune in for those when they happen. The one that happened earlier this month was two distributors, Skip Campbell and Dondi Nettles, emceed by Ben Seaman. And when I listened to that call, I was just absolutely struck by how well done it was. If you haven't heard it, I urge you to go to the website and listen to it. What they presented was firsthand, very personal views of what makes Protandim different and how each of you can go about using that information to get that message across to the people with whom you speak. It emphasized very, very strongly the value and the uniqueness of our peer-reviewed science. And several things came to light and really struck me during that presentation. And I thought, again, at the risk of being redundant, I didn't want to take anything away from the excellent job they did. One limitation was that it was an audio presentation, so they couldn't use visual aids. And I'm going to just reemphasize some of the things that Skip and Don covered with a little bit of visual enhancement for you. And I hope you take this right to heart and use it, because there's some very powerful tools available to you, and I want to make sure that you understand exactly what they mean and exactly what you can do with them. So the first part of this is stay tuned to Life Vantage. Stay tuned to this company. Why is that so important with this particular product? This product is different from many other products that are sold similarly. One of the earliest MLM products was from Tupperware. And you can pick up a Tupperware bowl with a snap-on lid, and it doesn't take you long to realize exactly what that is, how it works, and what it may mean in your life. And Tupperware literally changed the way most all of us do things. It was a really useful product, but one that's very easy to get your arms around. Protandim, on the other hand, is at the other end of the spectrum. It's a complicated product. If you haven't already figured that out, you will soon. And it's also a product that is not self-evident at the beginning. 5 years ago, my view of what Protandim is, what it does, was very different from my view today. In fact, my view today is very different from my view last week. And I'll point out how that changed. This is a changing canvas, and it's going to take some work on your part to keep up, just as it takes a lot of work on my part to keep up. So that's why staying tuned to the new information that comes to light is so important with this product in particular. The question that was raised in the science call was, what distinguishes Protandim from other products? And you've already heard this today from a couple of speakers, and it's worth reiterating and re-emphasizing. One of the major distinguishing features of Protandim is the peer-reviewed published science. And, you know, I have grown up literally for the past 40 years of my life dealing with the peer review process. And so to me, it's second nature. I don't even think about what those two words mean. But about a month ago, maybe 6 weeks ago, I got an email from Ben Seaman. And he said, someone asked me, what does peer reviewed really mean? And he wanted me to just explain it to him. And I sent him an email that had this text. And I don't expect you to read all that, too many words. That's more for me. But I explained in detail what those two words, peer-reviewed, really means. When scientists do a study, they write a manuscript describing it. And that manuscript is submitted to a journal for possible publication. And I say possible because you're by no means assured that your manuscript is ever going to be published in a reputable peer-reviewed journal. The journal editor selects two or three academic scientists who are well qualified to judge the quality of the work and the soundness of the conclusions that are drawn. Usually, they are leaders or at least well-known contributors to the field of the science that's being submitted. They act as anonymous reviewers of the work. They're free to question anything and everything about that work. They're free to ask you to do additional experimentation. That frequently happens. They're free to question your conclusions. They're free to question your statistical analysis. This is scrutiny of the highest degree. The author must then respond to that critique from each of these reviewers until all their concerns are met. Sometimes that process takes 4, 5, 6 months, occasionally even longer. It can go back and forth a couple of times between the authors and the reviewers. The reviewers are anonymous to each other as well as to the authors, but they do get to see each other's comments. And often what one reviewer says, maybe in the first round, will be picked up by a second reviewer in the second round. And this thing goes back and forth until all the questions are settled and everyone involved agrees this is a sound, well-done study. All right, it takes a while just to describe that process, and trust me, it takes a long time to get through that process. In some journals, only 5 or 10% of the papers that are submitted to that journal are ultimately accepted and published. That's how rigorous the process is. And that's why peer-reviewed articles in reputable journals are much more reliable than something you Google from the internet, something you find on a blog that could be put up by absolutely any person on the planet with no review at all. That's why peer-reviewed articles are more reliable, more informative, and more dependable than what a company may publish itself on its own website. There's no peer review there. A company can say virtually anything unless it flagrantly violates a law, and then it might be taken off. Right. So peer-reviewed published papers really mean a lot. One of your most powerful tools and your single most informative resource is PubMed.gov. And again, this was talked about by Dondi Nettles extensively, how he uses this tool. And I would really like for all of you to get familiar with this. There are 10 characters to type in, PubMed.gov, all right? You type that in your browser, and what comes up is a screen that looks like this. It's just like a Google search. The difference is This is not searching everything that anybody and his neighbor has posted on the internet. This is searching the peer-reviewed, published biomedical literature, not just from this nation, but from the entire planet. Every journal that meets the qualifications, that conducts peer-reviewed publication of biomedical research, is included in this database that's run by the National Library of Medicine of the United States of America. PubMed.gov is your tax dollars at work, and it's probably one of the most efficient and useful uses of your tax dollars. There are many, but this is up there. And it's an outstanding contribution of this country to the well-being of the entire planet, right? It works just like Google. So if you go bring up PubMed and you type in the search field something like Protandim, and you hit enter, what you see is all of the publications specifically discussing Protandim in the published peer-reviewed biomedical literature. And you might expect there would be hundreds because you may not have a feel for how this thing works. Six is a very substantial number for where we are and how long we've been at this. Let me tell you, if you had done this search 1 year ago, there were three, right? So in the last year, this has doubled. There's a seventh waiting in the wings, and I hope soon you'll see a seventh paper there. These are independently funded for the most part. The first couple were funded by the company, and everything after that has been independent, funded by private agencies such as Parent Project Muscular Dystrophy, such as the American Heart Association, and from federal funding, such as the National Institutes of Health. If you click on any one of those publications, what you see is the entire abstract, right? And if you see the icon in the upper right of this screen, it says free, full text PDF file, a reprint format of this paper. Again, that icon always appears if the research was funded at least in part by federal money. That is, your tax dollars also supported in some part this study on the effect of Protandim on Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Because your tax dollars paid for it, you're entitled to download the full text research in a PDF file. And all six of the papers shown here have those downloadable PDF files available. If you go back to the initial screen and you type in, let's say, oxidative stress, you would find 81,000 hits. All right, that's a lot of research on oxidative stress. Protandim is aimed at reducing oxidative stress, but you can search more focused on the term Protandim, or more broadly on the term oxidative stress. If you type in oxidative stress and any medical condition that you comes to your mind, you'll get, again, a number of hits. If you in this case, oxidative stress and dialysis, which is a procedure that people undergo when they're in kidney failure, you find an amazing 1,113 publications on oxidative stress and dialysis. You can focus even more tightly if you want to by searching a topic with NRF2. Again, Protandim, and for newcomers in the audience, I'll explain what NRF2 is and what Protandim does to it in just a moment. But here, if you do a search of cancer and NRF2, that is, what NRF2 activating agents do to cancer in various studies, 475 papers already, and this is rapidly expanding. I typed this in to make this screen capture a few days ago, and looking down the first few hits, the hits are arranged by the most recent. So what you see here is a paper that may have just been published within the last few days. And so this number is changing continuously. You see the most recent stuff first. And as I was looking at the results of this hit, I noticed one paper that really changed an important way that I have viewed Protandim vis-a-vis cancer. And I discussed this with a number of you this morning, and this is a big topic, Protandim and cancer patients. And this paper looks at not Protandim, but curcumin, one of our ingredients. And curcumin in and of itself is a Nrf2 activator. Protandim is greatly amplified. It works better than curcumin because we've got the synergy of the five. But the mechanism is the same. Curcumin activates Nrf2. Protandim activates Nrf2 more strongly. And just look at the title of this paper, and I think this can speak to you. There, it's a little obtuse maybe, but you can look at that title and figure it out. Curcumin, the golden spice from Indian saffron, the researcher here is Dr. Agarwal from India, and he has a particular affinity, I think, for Ayurvedic medicine, for traditional medicine from India. He's at Baylor Medical Center in Houston, Texas, well known in the field of Nrf2 activators. So curcumin is a chemosensitizer and radiosensitizer for tumors. What does that mean? Tumors are treated with chemotherapy and with radiation. The reason for treating tumors with those two treatments, and they both increase oxidative stress substantially, is that unlike most other therapies that you get from the doctor that tend to make your cells work better, these two are designed to kill cells because your body, if you have cancer, contains cells that are rogue cells. They're out of control. They're multiplying, trying to overtake your body. And a concern has been because chemotherapy and radiotherapy both increase oxidative stress in an attempt to kill cancer cells. There's been a controversy for a number of years. Is antioxidant therapy a good idea here? Because you may actually protect the cells that you want to kill. You're using a therapy to put focused oxidative stress on these cells with the idea of pushing them over the edge, killing them. And therefore, I have recommended to everyone who's asked me for the last 5 years, should I take Protandim if I've got a cancer diagnosis, I'm about to undergo chemotherapy or radiation therapy? And my conservative response has been, because this is controversial, some scientists argue, don't do it because you may protect the cancer. Others have said, do it because you may protect the other tissues more than you protect the cancer. We didn't really have a definitive answer. This paper says, activating Nrf2 actually sensitizes the tumors to radiation and to chemo. So it's going to have a bigger effect. Okay? And the other part of that title is just as important. Nrf2 activators are chemoprotectors and radioprotectors for normal organs. So imposing a Nrf2 activator changes the way that tumors and normal tissues respond to radiation, and it does it in the best possible way. It makes the radiation more effective at eliminating the tumor and less effective at causing damage to the rest of your body that really needs to survive. Right. So again, what's my point here? This is a changing scenario every week. I do these searches myself. I look at the most recent new papers that have just hit the press, and this is the kind of thing I learn. And it changes the way I view Protandim. I said what I say today about it is very different from what I said 4 or 5 years ago, and this is precisely the reason. We're in the middle of a rapidly changing field, and we need to stay tuned to this company and to sites such as PubMed.gov to get the latest information. So don't just sit back and say, I learned about Protandim a year ago, I'm going to use what I learned then. You need to keep at it. I wish it were simpler, but it isn't. It's complicated. So hang in there. Do your best to keep up with this. do your best to use this as an impressive tool. If you sit down with someone who's trying to decide, should I take this supplement or another supplement, a competing product perhaps, flip open your laptop, type in PubMed.gov and say, what's the other supplement you're concerned about or considering? Type it in. Now, some of them actually do have peer-reviewed published studies, not many. Not many products. Most products you type in, you get no hits at all. It's not there. And they may say, well, the company says on their website it does this, it does that. Okay, if it's true, they should submit it to a journal. They should get a peer-reviewed published paper. Then it will mean something. All right, so use these tools. They are very, very powerful. The second part of this, my stay tuned theme, is stay tuned with Protandim. And I'm using a slightly different definition of tuned in this case, but I think it works well. And I'm going to interject one slide here. I know there are a lot of new people in the audience who haven't heard me talk before. It's always a dilemma because I know there are new people. Should I go back to square one and use this time to reiterate what Protandim is, how it works? And my concern is there's a lot of new stuff I want to talk to you about. And so there's a dilemma. Do I try to bring everyone up to speed? Maybe the best solution, if you're new, look at the website, look at some of the previous presentations that may start at square one and fill you in. But for those of you who are new to this group, let me explain what Protandim is and what it does. Protandim is a NRF2 activator, and I realize that doesn't say anything to you guys if you're not a biochemist or have a PhD in some biomedical science. But I'm going to tell you very briefly what a NRF2 activator is and what it does. It can be viewed as a biochemical wake-up call. Literally, these substances are messengers. And the way Protandim acts, and many of you have seen this before, but this is the single summary slide of what Protandim does when it approaches a human cell. And so in the upper right there, you see something labeled Protandim. You've just taken a Protandim. It's found its way into your bloodstream. It's reaching every cell in your body. And when Protandim approaches any human cell, there are receptors on the surface of that cell. It's the analogy I use. It's like Protandim steps on your front porch, and it rings your doorbell. What happens inside that cell is there's a change occurring, just like when your chime goes off or your doorbell rings. Pushing the button outside has caused a change inside. In this case, an enzyme has been activated. An enzyme is a machine that does something chemically within the cell. In this case, it's a kinase. You don't have to remember that. And here it's signified by being activated. It turned yellow, but now it's turned on by Protandim. What does it do? Well, the important player here is that little red circle labeled NRF2. That's the biochemical messenger that needs to send information to the DNA in the nucleus of every cell in your body. And it's being held outside. The messenger is stuck to a blue protein there called KEAP1. And that complex is modified by this kinase. And what you can see is a little yellow group was added to NRF2. It's been chemically modified. So that activated enzyme caused by Protandim ringing the doorbell, if you will, has modified NRF2, changed its structural shape. It looks different to the blue protein that's holding it. And as a result, the blue protein lets go of the NRF2. The blue protein, by the way, is stuck to the skeleton of the cell, so it's outside the nucleus. And that's where it's been holding NRF2. Now that NRF2 has been modified, it's released by the blue protein, and it's free to diffuse into the nucleus of every cell where the DNA resides. The DNA is the master blueprint for that cell, contains the plans for producing everything that cell needs to make. When Protandim goes in there, when NRF2 goes in there, it now has access to 25,000 genes that are in the nucleus of every cell in your body. And about four or 500 of those genes have receptors where that NRF2 can bind and act. You can think of it as a key and a lock, or you can think of it as an electrical switch that gets flipped. The NRF2 finds the 500 genes that it can modify. It binds to them. It turns on that gene, and the end result is all 500 of those genes upregulate the thing that they encode, the blueprint for which they are for some product that the cell makes. So in this case, protective enzymes are produced in response to Protandim. That's how it works in a nutshell. The actual biochemistry is a little more complicated, but not much. That's very close to the way I would explain this to my peers. That's what Protandim does. It activates NRF2. The cell makes more of its protective survival-related enzymes. So here I'm using a slightly different twist on the theme, stay tuned with Protandim. If you look up tune in a dictionary, which I did here, Merriam-Webster online, you type in tune, and you find that there are several definitions. It's to adjust musical pitch. Everyone's familiar with that. You can tune an instrument. You can tune a piano. It brings it into harmony. It's a way of adjusting something for precise functioning. So you can take your car into a mechanic and you can tune up the engine. It's to make more precise, more intense, or effective. And here at definition one, the example given there is tuned her guitar. Okay, so you can tune something to the right frequency, the right pitch. And if you look this definition up a few years from now, I'm hoping at the bottom there may be an addition. As, for example, grandma tuned her genome with Protandim. All right. Well, how is that going to work? Let me expand a little bit. A piano keyboard has 88 notes on it, and each note, you probably don't think about this even if you play a piano, but each note has an assigned frequency. You hit that note, you hear a tone that is a very precise frequency. Those are the actual frequencies for all 88 of those. They are defined. And if that key is not on that particular frequency, we would say that piano is out of tune, right? So let's suppose that in 1947, Grandma bought a brand new piano, and this is one chord from that keyboard, from the chord below middle C, so it's from low C to mid C, 13 notes. Each of them has a defined frequency, and when that piano was delivered to Grandma, every one of those 13 keys was right on, or very close to, the defined frequency for each of those notes. And as happens with pianos, let's assume that for whatever reasons, Grandma's piano spent 50 years in the attic. And maybe the grandchildren discover it, bring it down, dust it off, and check it out. Well, after 50 years in the attic, things had changed. And if you hit those 13 keys now, you'll find that they're not on the precise frequency. The piano is out of tune and needs to be brought back into tune. It needs to be tuned up by a guy who knows what he's doing. He will bring tuning forks. He will listen very carefully, adjust each of those keys until it's back where it should be. And the same thing happened to Grandma, by the way, in those 50 years. If you look at her genome, and instead of 88 keys, we're looking at 25,000 keys in the genome, where each key is one gene. And to be properly functioning, if we looked at Grandma's genome when she was 20 years old, no oxidative stress to speak of, those genes would have been in tune. These are the 400 genes, and this is real data from my laboratory, from human cells, 400 genes that respond most to Protandim being added to the culture medium. And the height of, there are 400 little bars here and you can't see them individually, but the height of each one tells you how frequently that gene is being expressed, how often that blueprint is being called out of the nucleus of that cell and functionally translated into the product for which that blueprint encodes. This is the way those 400 genes are expressed when oxidative stress is low. So we could call this a properly tuned genome. Because you can't see the individual genes when there are that many, I've taken a little area in the center part of this randomly in that red box, which is about 63 genes, and we're going to look at that a little more closely. They're now spread out. You can see them individually. The name of each gene is on the bottom of the axis, and they don't mean much to you, and some of them don't mean much to me. Some of them, in fact, are of unknown function. We know the gene is there. We know its sequence. We don't fully understand what that gene does. But in other cases, we know exactly what it does, what disease it may be involved in. So this is, I think, 63 genes chosen just to be in the middle of that range. And this is how they're expressed when oxidative stress is low, specifically when protandim is in the medium. If we grow, and this is in a human cell line, if we grow these same cells without protandim under conditions that have oxidative stress, what do you think it looks like? It looks like that. Okay? So that's equivalent to grandma's piano after 50 years in the attic. And the difference between that and this is protandim. All right? It's a dramatic illustration. And let me point out to you, too, how dramatically things have changed. Protandim was developed primarily to affect three gene products, superoxide dismutase, or SOD, catalase, and glutathione peroxidase. And the literature, as of 5 years ago, led us to believe that this could happen, this would happen with protandim. And indeed, it did affect those three genes. What we've learned in the last 5 years is that it affects not only those 63 genes, but these 400 genes, right? So three of those are SOD, catalase, and glutathione, or glutathione peroxidase. Have we realized that protandim does a lot more than that? You bet. We went from three genes to 400 or 500 genes that we're now talking about. Each of those genes has its own story. And your eyes would quickly glaze over if I went through the first 200 of those. So what I'm going to do is give you an example on each end of the spectrum in the few minutes remaining. One of the genes that caught my eye when I looked at this entire 400 genes was at one end of the spectrum. That is, of all the genes that are downregulated, which one is downregulated the most? And this gene called fatty acid binding protein 4, meant nothing to me at the time, was strongly downregulated by protandim. And I'll show you the data in a moment. And so what do I do when I see something like that? Well, I go to PubMed.gov that I showed you earlier. I type in fatty acid binding protein 4, or FABP4, the name of that gene. And my question is, what is this involved in? Is it good to be high? Is it good to be low? What do we know collectively about fatty acid binding protein 4? And this paper appeared just in the last month. And it says that this one and a related gene, fatty acid binding protein 5, another gene, are related to the metabolic syndrome, all right? That's epidemic in this country. That's when people get older, they get obese. It involves inflammation. It involves atherosclerosis. It involves type 2 diabetes. It involves calcification of arteries. A lot of nasty things are related to these two gene products. The conclusions from this paper I just kind of summarized it. FABP4 and to a lesser extent FABP5 contribute to insulin resistance, which is part of type 2 diabetes, to atherosclerosis, hardening of the arteries, cardiovascular disease. Reduction of FABP4 provides a striking resistance to the development of insulin resistance and multiple features of the metabolic syndrome. All right, that's powerful. In this paper, they could lower FABP4 by genetic manipulations, things that we can't do to ourselves, but we can do to animals in a lab, provided resistance to metabolic syndrome. And at the bottom there, FABP4 associated with metabolic syndrome, inflammation, coronary calcification in humans. What does Protandim do to it? On the left, you see the effect of Protandim on human cells in culture. The left bar is the control without Protandim. At two concentrations of Protandim increasing, you see an 85% reduction of this FABP4 gene product. The related one, FABP5, showed a 66% reduction in response to Protandim. Right? The higher this gene is, the more likely you are to get metabolic syndrome, calcified arteries, and the related bad things that happen. At the other end of the spectrum, another gene, and again, when I saw this one, this is one of the most potently upregulated genes by Protandim. The gene is named AKR1B10. That didn't mean anything to me, even though I'm a biochemist. It's a human aldo-keto reductase, but I put it in PubMed to see what is this gene doing. Protandim strongly cranks it up. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? These two papers were published within the last year, again, rapidly moving scenario. And look at this title, this gene, AKR1B10, promotes cell survival, sounds good, by regulating lipid synthesis and eliminating carbonyls. Well, you may not know what carbonyls are, but carbonyls are related to T-bars, which you have heard before, lipid peroxidation products. The conclusions of these two papers is that this gene responds to free radical damage, which results in formation of toxic lipid peroxidation products. So that broadly is T-bars. More specifically, it's talking about one of those products, 4-hydroxynonenal, 4-HNE, which may ultimately lead to cell death. These aldehydes damage the DNA. They can cause mutations. And this gene efficiently, the gene product, efficiently catalyzes the reduction of 4-HNE, protecting cells from toxic effects. What does Protandim do to this gene? The one on the left is the control. And here you see two concentrations, a very low and a higher concentration of Protandim, a 3,200%, 32-fold increase in the production of the of this gene product. And this is a good one. The more of this you have, the more protected you are, right? And each of those 400 genes can be analyzed in this way. And I have to tell you, I haven't made my way through all 400 of them, but I spend hours and hours ferreting out what those genes are, what they do, and the overall predominant theme is exactly what you've seen here. The genes that help our cells survive are upregulated. The genes that are doing the damage, causing the problems, are being decreased. So I think that's pretty much the end of what I have to say. I want to tell you, a lot of these guys have contributed to what I've told you today. So thank you for your attention. I want you to stay tuned to Life Vantage. I want you to stay tuned to PubMed.com. I want you to stay tuned with Protandim. So thank you very much.